equals 0, right? Okay? We found out last time that to write the equation of the tangent plane at the point x sub 0, y sub 0, z 0, what did we do? What did we do? We got the gradient, right? Del f, evaluated this as p 0, correct? And what? That gradient, actually, we said was going to be normal, right? This red thing is normal to the surface, right? So del f, oh, I have different colors now. Evaluated at p sub 0 is normal to all the way we derived it was we said it's normal to all the tangent lines, right? To all the r primes of this. Or you can just say it's normal to the surface s at p sub 0. So if it's normal to s at p sub 0, if we want to find the equation of the tangent plane, what did we say was the equation of the tangent plane? Sorry, I'm confused what color to use. Okay. Equation of the tangent plane we said was what? Because that's the normal already, right? So that's your normal vector. Will just be, let's see, what was del f again? Del f evaluated at p0 is really this vector, right? It's fx evaluated at p0, comma, fy evaluated at p0, fz evaluated at p0. Okay? And so therefore, if that's normal to the surface at p0, therefore the equation of the tangent plane is what? Is fx evaluated at p0, which in your book, Sokowski wrote it like this, fx evaluated there, okay? Times what? X minus x0 plus fy evaluated at x0, y0, z0 times y minus y0, right? Plus fz evaluated at x0, y0, z0 times z minus z0 equals 0. Correct?
What's tp?
Tangent. Oh, right? I thought I wrote it like that last time, right? That was the tangent plane. And of course, we said sometimes you can make your numbers smaller, right? Because, yeah, these could be like 20, 40, 60. You could use 2, 4, 6. You could use what? 1, 2, 3. Okay? We just need a normal. But they came from the gradient. Do you remember that? Okay.
You can also take out negative.
Yeah, if they're all negatives, you can take out negative. You can, all you need really is a normal vector. So if your del f is an ugly number, it's an ugly vector. Give me an example, Jim. Negative. 12.
87.4.
No, don't put decimals. Negative 6 and let's say what? 4, right? So you can use what vector? You can use a normal vector that's like what? You can divide everybody by negative 2 if you wish, right? Okay, so you can use what? 6, 3, negative 2. Is that okay? You can understand why I think we gave an example like that, okay? And the normal line is just easy also, right? Normal line goes in the same direction as the gradient. So it's going to be what? X, the parametric equations are x sub 0 plus fx, let me just write it like this, evaluated at p sub 0 times t, right? Y is y sub 0 plus fy evaluated at p sub 0 times t. And z is z 0 plus fz evaluated at p 0 times t. And again, you don't have to stick to fx, fy, fz, you can make them nicer, okay? Reduce your numbers if you can. Question?
In the direction of derivatives, can we also simplify gamma or not?
Well, that's a good question. Let's see. Can the directional derivative, how did we define this? Evaluated at p0. What do you think? It's del f, right? Dotted with what? The unit vector. So the, well, of course, yeah, you know this has to be evaluated at p0, right? So Anthony's question is, can we also do that with that directional derivative? Can we also reduce our numbers? What do you think?
Yeah.
No. Del f is del f for that. Do you understand? Okay? So for directional derivative, whatever the answer is the answer. You can cannot make it like, I think somebody showed me, you know, on her desk, like you divide by 9. Because if that's your vector, that's your vector. Here, this is a scalar, right? If that's your scalar, that's your scalar. In fact, it is a, right? So you cannot mess, you, I think, Anthony, your question is, can I mess with this?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
You understand why you can mess with your Fx, Fy, Fz here? You understand why? That's equal 0, so yeah, you can reduce, right? You can divide across the board by some number. Okay.
Oh, one more question.
Question,
del F, from a... from a point, any del f from the plane to a point is going to be a normal vector, right?
Yeah, and that's what I was going to tie up today.
Oh.
Okay. For, yeah, we just saw that last time, and I don't think we really summarized it, okay? This is going to be normal to end all the tangent lines, right? Correct? That's how we, I think that's how we explained it. We said, okay, this is... it's defined by some curves. See, and you can actually have a lot of other curves, and all these del f at p0 will be perpendicular to all those r prime of p's, right? Remember? You remember that story? We said del f dotted with r prime of t is going to be 0, no matter what curve you're talking about, okay? So we said it's normal, and then yeah, we said, I don't think we said this last time, we can also say, yeah, it's normal to the surface at that point. Alright? And yeah, normal is significant, right?
That's kind of the easier way of doing the stuff in chapter 15, right? Where we took
somehow you can tie it up to chapter 15. Let's not do it today, okay? Because I know we'll tie up all these pieces. Somehow it somehow ties up with that curve thing that we were doing before. And normal, another word for normal, of course, is what? Perpendicular, right? So it looks like your del f is perpendicular to your surface at that point, okay? Now the other thing, I just gave you an example, but I did not formalize it. I'm always trying my best to draw a nice surface. Your surface could also be defined as, not as f of x, y, z equals 0, you can also define it as what? Z equals f of x, y. I don't know if you remember, I gave an example last time that looked kind of like this. Do you see the difference?
Yes. Didn't we do an example
with that? Yeah, we did an example with that, right? Okay. And the way we did the example, what we said was, well, we can actually write this as f of x, y, z equals 0, right? How?
By subtracting
your z. This is actually a theorem in your book, but I was treating it very lightly and gave it as an example. But you can see it follows, right? Okay. So therefore, if you want to write the equation of your tangent plane for this one, what is it? Same thing, we can use big F, but big F is also little f, right? Fx. Evaluated at x0, y0, you can drop the z0, okay? Times what? Times x minus x0. If you look at the example, it's similar except my notation is different. I thought I'd explain that you can also think of it like this. Partial of little f with respect to y, x0, y0 times y minus y0. And then what did we say? Because that's minus z, what's the partial with respect to z? The derivative of z with respect to z is negative 1, partial of f, right, big f. So it's negative 1, that's why you had a negative 1, z minus z0 equals 0, okay? The way this was written in your book, you can write this as z minus z0 is equal to fx, x0, y0, x minus x0 plus fy, x0, y0. Y minus y0. Yeah, I gave you an example, and even without this, I think you could have figured that out. As long as you can write it as f of x, y, z equals 0. I did try to tell you the story of the tangent plane and the curve. Are you okay with that? Do you understand that? The tangent plane just approximates the value, right? The change in that thing. Okay. So then maybe you wonder, so what are we doing here? What is this all about? What do you think this is all about? Remember, there was another thing we discovered last meeting about del f. Remember, calculus always talks of change, right? What did we discover about Del F last meeting?
Rate of increase, rate of increase.
It talks about your rate of in, what does it tell you about the rate of increase or rate of decrease?
The maximum rate of increase.
The maximum, if you want your function to change rapidly, how should you move from a certain point? Let's say you are at this point, and let's say this, yeah, and we'll talk about examples later. Let's say you're at this point and you want your function to change rapidly, increase rapidly. How should you move? Didn't we discover that? See, that's what I told you.
Along the del.
Along the del, right? Okay. The maximum rate of increase of the function is along the del, right? Or if you want it to decrease really, really fast, you go opposite the del. And that maximum change is given by how much? It's the magnitude of the del, right? Okay? So now you're looking at this and you say, oh, so what does this mean? And what did we discover when we were talking tangent planes and normal lines? That the del is really always just what? Normal to that? To the surface, right? Okay, so it looks like the del is always just normal to the surface. So what does this mean? At a particular point, yeah, of course, it's always a piece of zero. Okay, we cannot just talk of those things. So this is the theorem I thought maybe we did not tie it up with, okay? It's a long theorem, maybe I should put it in there. So if you have a function, again, what am I trying to say here if I write it like this? Tell me, what am I trying to tell you here?
F
is a function of three variables, right? Okay. And it's differentiable at a point, let's say x0, y0, z0. What else do we know? S, let's say, is the level surface. Do you remember level surface from 16.1, I think? Do you remember that? Nobody remembers. See, the faces tell already, right? Okay, let's write this first, and then let's see. Analyze the theorem. I guess we have to tie it up with level surface. Okay, do you remember how we created level surfaces? See, we have here a function of three variables, right? F of x, y, z. Okay, so we said long time ago, I don't remember when, in 16.1, I think, we said we can't actually draw that function, right? Correct? At best, we can visualize that that function is acting on what? A three-dimensional shape, right? Or object, you understand? It could be the entire space, or it could be a subset of the space. You get it? Okay? So let's say it's differentiable at P0. What again does that mean, differentiable at P0? You can write it as fx, right? Delta x plus fy, delta y, remember that? Plus fz, fz, delta z, correct? Plus epsilon 1, delta x, plus epsilon 2, delta y, right? Plus epsilon, do you remember? That strange formula, okay? Level surface, do you know what level surface means?
Parallel to xy plane.
Level surface is a surface, so that's why it's surface, right? Remember how we have, actually, how many letters do we have? We are in 4D now, right? Correct? Aren't we in 4D? We have X, Y, Z, W, right? And we said, oh, I can't visualize that, right? Correct? But you can visualize the level surface, right? Right? We'll give you an example. We can give, the level surfaces look like this, right? So let's say you have level surface 1. This corresponds, let's say, to what? This is W equals, let's say, what? Okay, 0. There's another level surface underneath. See, I tried. This is W equals, let's say, K1. Alright? And so on and so forth. You can draw another surface here. Okay? What's the meaning? If you have W is equal to F of X, Y, Z. Is Isaac here? Yes, he said. You were asking him, we need to have some kind of physics here, right? Physical interpretation. I forgot to pre- anyway, next time I'll show you. Math is the purest of them all, and then followed by physics. And then chemistry, I think. And then biology. And then psychology. Oh, is that understand? According to purity, math is the purest, because we just know our theory, we don't know how to apply. Followed by physics. Yeah, Victor seems to know, and I think the next one is chemistry. Followed by biology. Or is it the other way? I think, yeah, and then followed by psychology.
Where is
Peter? Are you recording?
I don't know how to do it right.
Followed by... I think it's something like this. It's in my office. It's like the science is arranged by purity. This is the purest, and this is not so pure. Okay? Because what they say is sociology is applied psychology. Oh, yeah, I think it will make sense if we think of it. Sociology is applied psychology.
It's applied biology.
Psychology is applied biology, right? I think it makes sense, right? Because don't they explain our behavior based on how we are made up?
Yeah.
Okay. Biology is applied chemistry. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Chemistry, this one I don't understand. Chemistry is applied chemistry. Can you give me a simple example?
The energy of the molecules is described by physics.
Oh, that's right. Those little...
Everything.
So everything is really explained by physics?
Yes, everything is explained by physics.
And math is actually way up there. Math is the purest. It's supposed to be, yeah, all of these guys are supposed to be applied math.
Okay.
So let's go. So let's go back and see if we can apply what we're learning about these level curves. So let's say W equals F of X, Y, Z talks about the temperature. Remember I told you this is acting on some 3D something, right? Shape, correct? So your function describes the temperature of your domain, right? Okay? What do the level surfaces tell you? So like if this is level surface 1 corresponding to W equals K0, let's say that's temperature, you're saying that everywhere on this surface the temperature is K0 degrees. Do you understand? Okay? So in fact we have a term here, these are what you call isothermal surfaces. So all these, so here it's K1 degrees, right? Here it's K2 degrees, and so on and so forth. So you substitute whatever you want. So imagine your 3D object, and you cut it like this, and all along here the temperature is 90 degrees. You understand?
Okay.
So like here, you have a 3D object, you're talking of the temperature, right? So like, this is the shape of your level surface. Everywhere here on this surface, the temperature is, let's say, 90 degrees. On the other hand, if you have another surface, maybe everywhere here, the temperature is 150 degrees. And it doesn't have to look the same shape in general, right? You understand? Okay? So that's the situation for 4D, okay? And of course, we can bring it down to 2D. How? You can have a function of two variables, right? So you have f equals f of x, y, right? Differentiable where?
P0, x0, y0,
because remember if it's two variables, it's just acting on a plane or a subset thereof, right? You understand? Instead of level surface, what do we call it?
Level curve.
Level curve. Okay? Instead of del f, x0, y0, z0, we should have what? Del little f, x0, y0. Right? Then instead of this, I'll have del f, x0, y0. Instead of using the word normal, because now we're just flat on the plane, what's the word used?
Orthogonal.
Orthogonal to S of P0. And then the direction of, for the maximum rate of change is orthogonal. Not to S, but to where? Oh, instead of S, by the way, what do we call it? Do you understand why it's C? Because it's a curve. Perpendicular to C. Okay? The good news is for two variables, we can actually draw it, right? Correct? For two variables, you can have z equals f of x, y, right? And an easy example to draw maybe is you can have something like a paraboloid, right? This is your z equals f of x, y. And then you can, again, give an application to this. Like what? What application can you give here? I don't know, the books usually use pressure. Barometric pressure. I don't know why. Okay, I guess this is, remember the contour maps we were talking about, right? Like if this is elevation or whatever, then let's say this is your z equals k. Remember we talked about dropping this down and getting your level curve down here, right? Okay? So if you put a lot of these level curves, the drawing, the counterpart of your level curves will now be here. It will look something like this. Understand what I'm saying? Okay? So what happens here is, let's say you say this is z equals, let's say a, z equals 5. Of course, it doesn't correspond to that graph. Okay? But if this is pressure, you say it's a whatever. What is your pressure unit? Atmospheric pressure or something. Okay? And this is what you call your... What do you call this? Isobars is what they call this. Okay. I was promising to tie it up with that. Okay. How can we tie up that story with these two guys? Can you help me, Jeremy?
I was kind of thinking about it in 3D. The del would be kind of from one plane to the other. The del would share between planes. But would the del describe the change between each plane?
The del will describe how you should move. Right?
So we're talking about temperature.
So if you're here, this is your P0, and there's your del, right? Evaluated at P0. You have to move that way. Remember, you're in a 3D space, right? Okay, this is your domain. You have to move that way so that your temperature increases really fast. If you want the temperature to increase, decrease really fast, then you have to move the other way.
Would that be the same on the plane, or would it?
No. Like, Nick said, it depends on what your point is. So like your del here, P1, might look like this. Okay? I mean, yeah, the only way to do it is to experience doing the homework, okay? So then you see. But yeah, that's how it is. Yeah, it depends. So if you're here, maybe the del could be moving somehow like that. Get it?
So if I'm understanding this correctly, I'm kind of coming up with an image in my mind. Say we had a light source at the bottom, we're dealing with temperature, and that light source exudes, radiates a certain spherical heat. You know, it gets cooler as it gets further away from the light, right?
Yeah.
So those dells, if we were to draw, if we were to draw like the aura of the light where the heat is dissipating, the del would be the shortest distance from that point to like the circle,
the shortest distance
around where the heat, it radiates the heat. That would be.
I'm kind of not, I kind of don't like the idea of radiating because it's, to me it's more like integration. Now we're talking about the next chapter where your heat is like flowing like flux. You understand? These are defined. Like these are just saying over here this is how hot it is. So there's no change. You know what I don't like about that example?
That would be like a better example.
What?
So you have a continental shelf when you're like out in the
Yes.
And then you go and you go and you go and then drop.
So it's like these are fixed temperatures. The way you say it with that light is it's like it's changing, right?
Yeah.
That's going to be chapter 18.
Well, I think that's what's confusing.
Yeah, we're going to integrate and the change, the whatever.
We're thinking of the change in
like
between
planes. Yeah, it's, but this is a good one that you said, Ethan. It's just fixed, like continental levels, right? So over here it's what? How, you know, to 400 degrees.
And then here it's 4,000.
Yes.
Gotcha.
Okay, so it's just fixed temperature. Okay?
The dell doesn't have to be always.
It's always normal at that point. But what the meaning of normal is, you know, I tried to draw it so it's like this. So, so if, it's, if you're here, then maybe normal really points that way. It's so hard to draw, right? But so normal here is like here, normal here is like that. Do you understand, guys? Normal is like
so
this.
So if we were to draw a tangent line from
you have to
curve.
Exactly.
That's our normal.
Do you understand what yeah, Nick was saying? It's, yeah, draw the tension line first, then draw your normal. Right? Okay, so it's going to point different directions because it's wavy like that.
We can pick whatever point on the surface, right? It doesn't matter.
The homework will give you what point, so don't worry about it. So in fact, you know,
to me, in general, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, in general, you can pick up.
Okay.
Should we do a
sound like I thought it was a myth?
So then we don't talk. Yeah, let's see if we can actually apply this to a problem. Okay.